Thanks for joining us for CBN News Today. I'm Charlene Aaron.
And I'm Ephraim Graham. The TSA is increasing security measures at airports overseas. The agency is acting out of fresh concerns. Terrorists are working on a new generation of bombs that are hard to detect and designed to bring down airliners. There are new security rules for people taking direct flights from foreign airports to the United States. Electronic devices like cell phones, DVD players, and laptop computers must be turned on and working properly at security, or they may be kept off the plane. It's an inconvenience many overseas travelers say they're prepared to handle.
I'm not going to stop flying just because of things like this. You know, then terrorists win if you stop flying.
TSA has new concerns bomb makers could be hiding explosives in those items, and that terrorists are hard at work trying to develop an explosive that would go undetected by airport security.
Our job is to try to anticipate the next attack, not simply react to the last one.
This latest directive comes because of growing fears radicals from Al-Qaeda's Yemen branch may be looking to organize a terrorist attack. That same branch was responsible for the 2009 underwear bomber. Officials also believe some foreign fighters now in Syria are carrying passports, offering easy access to the United States. And with militants declaring an Islamic State in conquered territories of Syria and Iraq, critics charge the White House has allowed a new terrorist state to form.
This didn't have to happen. This is a failure of United States policy. And by the way, there still is none that I can discern, either a policy or a strategy to handle this situation. This guy Baghdadi, when he left Camp Buka, the prison camp that we ran, he said, "See you in New York." We now have the largest and richest enclave of radical terrorism in history that not only encompasses Iraq, as we know, but Iraq and Syria.
Syria and Iraq have become training grounds for jihadists from America and the West.
The Secretary of Homeland Security and White House say they will continue to evaluate whether this increased security will be applied to U.S. domestic flights.
Homeland Security Secretary Jay Johnson says deportation proceedings might be long delayed for the thousands of unaccompanied minors crossing the U.S.-Mexico border illegally. More than 50,000 have crossed over so far this year. Members of both parties are criticizing the Obama administration for its handling of the situation. Texas Democratic Representative Henry Kohler says the administration is one step behind a major dilemma that was foreseeable, while Governor Rick Perry says the state warned the administration about this crisis over 2 years ago.
And we're seeing that become reality today. This is a failure of diplomacy. It is a failure of leadership from the administration in Washington, D.C.
Johnson says the border crisis is a legal and humanitarian dilemma for the United States.
Our border is not open to illegal migration, and we are taking a number of steps to address it, including turning people around faster.
Johnson added the administration has dramatically sped up the processing of adults who enter the country illegally, and it is opening more detention facilities.
The situation in Israel is quickly deteriorating after the murder of an Arab teenager. It's suspected Jewish extremists killed him as revenge for the kidnapping and murder of three Israeli teens. Now tensions are rising as terrorists from Gaza launch waves of rockets at southern Israel. Our Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell has this story.
Israeli police arrested six Jewish suspects in connection with the murder of 16-year-old Mohammed Abu Qadir. The murder sparked Arab rioting in Jerusalem and northern Israel. In Jerusalem, rioters destroyed segments of the new light rail train tracks and some stations.
The rioting started here in Shu'afat, an Arab neighborhood in Jerusalem. You can see some of the damage here, and this morning they begun to clean up. This is the neighborhood where Abu Qadir lived, and relatives say he was abducted just hours after the three Jewish teens were buried.
This video shows Mohammed being pushed into a car. Police found his charred body a short time later in a Jerusalem forest. An autopsy showed he had been burned alive. Israeli leaders condemned the murder.
We shall not cover anything. We shall discover all the people that have acted criminally against somebody else, killed, kidnapped, tortured, and on that we shall not make any compromise.
Adding fuel to this combustible atmosphere, this video shows Israeli police beating Mohammed's cousin, 15-year-old Tariq Abu Qadir, an Arab-American citizen, during protests. Israel says it opened an investigation into the incident.
When did you go to?
Like the first part of Shafat, like in the front of Beit Hanina.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then they came attacking me and I woke up in the hospital.
If the policeman brutally beat a boy, that is illegal in Israel and all over the world. And if this is indeed the case, they will be brought to justice.
As the mourning continued for Mohammed, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu spoke by phone to his father. He said, "I would like to express my outrage and that of the citizens of Israel over the reprehensible murder of your son. We denounce all brutal behavior. The murder of your son is abhorrent and cannot be countenanced by any human being." Israel's Shin Bet, meanwhile, announced it had arrested one of the terrorists involved in the kidnap and murder of the Israeli teens. That drama tormented the nation for 18 days until the boys' bodies were found. Since then, terrorists have launched more than 160 rockets at southern Israel, damaging buildings but not causing injury. Overnight, Israel attacked 14 terror targets in Gaza, killing a number of Hamas members. Tensions are still running high, though Israelis are hoping the summer will cool down. But no one knows yet if this could be the beginning of a third Intifada uprising. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Shuafat, Jerusalem.
100 Muslim leaders in Great Britain are urging fellow Muslims not to join the jihad in Syria. British leaders are concerned Muslims will become radicalized and bring terrorism back to Britain. The British imams say fellow Muslims can still offer aid to those affected by the wars in Syria and Iraq from the UK in a responsible way. Authorities estimate as many as 500 Britons have traveled to Syria to fight, and that some may have crossed into Iraq.
In Ukraine, pro-Russian separatists are refusing to give up their fight against government forces. The separatists fled their headquarters in Slovyansk after government military recaptured it for Ukraine. The government's success there suggested it might finally be making gains in the battle against the rebels. The fighting over Slovyansk has claimed more than 400 lives since April. The separatists are regrouping in Donetsk, where thousands of rebels and supporters gathered in Central Square in the self-proclaimed Donetsk People's Republic.
The pastor of a Christian church in China has been sentenced to 12 years in prison. Zhang Xiaoji was convicted of fraud and gathering crowds to disturb the public order. His lawyer says Zhang was set up and targeted by the authorities. Zhang's church has the official sanction from the government allowing them to meet in the Henan province, but they've been arguing with local authorities over land for a new building.
And coming up, this little boy was kidnapped in his own front yard, but this story has a happy ending. See how Willie's faith and a saw set him free. Willie Myrick is a little guy, just 10 years old, and unfortunately, perfect prey for a kidnapper.
But Willie had a powerful weapon on his side, a gospel song. And that song has led to a worldwide testimony about Willie's faith and God's awesome power.
10-year-old Willie Myrick loves playing the drums, something he hopes one day to do at his church. Born to atheist parents, Willie was raised by his godmother, Codetta Bateman, who took him to church. It was there that he learned about God and developed a passion for the Bible.
Pastor, he talks about, like, different scriptures, and we're on Genesis 31 now. But he tells us a little stuff about him, and he goes over it every Sunday.
Codetta says she's seen Willie's faith blossom over the years.
Faith is important to this house and everything, and believing in God is important. So I should, you know, in this house, we go to church. You know God, you know Jesus.
While most kids his age are busy playing video games, Willie spends his free time studying the Word of God. His favorite scripture?
Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He says God is his best friend.
I always think that God is with me everywhere I go. Like when I'm in bed, he has a chair, he's just watching.
CBN News got a taste of his love for memorizing the books of the Bible.
Okay, ready? Go.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua judges Ruth.
In April, while playing with his dog in the front yard of his Atlanta home, Willie came face to face with a kidnapper, putting his childlike faith to the test.
Some guy came up in a silver or gray Honda Accord, man-tussled me in the car.
He man-tussled you in the car.
Willie says he wanted to yell for help, but the man covered his mouth. Traumatized, Willie feared for his life.
It's cursing. I was thinking that he's going to hurt me bad, real bad.
Thrown into the back of a locked car, Willie's fear soon gave way to faith in the form of a gospel song he learned at church. He began singing it in the back seat.
God's my deliverer. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Every praise is to our God.
The popular song Every Praise by Grammy Award-winning artist Hezekiah Walker is one of Willie's favorites.
I knew it by heart. I sang it, the whole thing by heart. And God, if you praise the Lord, he'll help you in a mysterious way.
Despite repeated threats, Willie sang nonstop while the man drove around for 3 hours.
I was just singing passion and pride, so I didn't care what happened.
Agitated by the constant singing, the man eventually let Willie out of the car. He was shaken, but unharmed.
I guess he was mad, so he dropped me out.
Willie ran to a nearby home and called his godmother. Police have no leads in the case, but have released this sketch of the man who kidnapped Willie. While she rejoices over his safe return, Willie's godmother continues to pray for the capture of the kidnapper.
He need to be caught. He got to be caught.
Willie's story made headlines around the world, leading to talk show appearances like Arsenio Hall. He even got the chance to perform his song of deliverance with Walker. While he's enjoying being in the media spotlight, he says he's just an ordinary kid who serves an extraordinary God.
It really doesn't matter to me. As long as I still have Jesus and he's still working, doing his little magic. Well, it's not magic, it's just power.
Just
what
power.
An inspirational little kid.
Oh, he's so
Such
wonderful.
Such faith.
Love little Willie.
I love him, and we'll continue to pray for him that he'll continue to grow in the things of God.
Indeed, indeed. Up next, the incredible story of one family torn apart by war and their miraculous reunion. More than 60 Nigerian girls kidnapped by the Islamic terrorist group Boko Haram escaped last week. An official in Chibok verified that 63 women and girls escaped while their captors fought a battle with Nigerian government troops. It's believed the girls were kidnapped about 2 weeks ago. In April, the world reacted in outrage when Boko Haram took some 300 girls from a school near Chibok. At least 200 of them are still in captivity. Meanwhile, at least 50 insurgents were killed during clashes with Nigerian soldiers as security forces repelled an attack on a military base in Borno.
For the last 20 years, rebel groups have been fighting for power in the Central African nation of the Congo. The battles have claimed more than 5 million lives and left millions more homeless.
John Jessup talked to one refugee from the Congo whose life was ripped to shreds before it was stitched back together right here in America.
As a janitor, Nene Renyaguza cleans up messes, fitting because for years he felt like his life was one big mess. A husband and father to three young kids, he had big dreams for his family. Then a deadly attack changed his life forever.
Nene's journey brought him here to the idyllic Midwestern setting of Columbia, Missouri. But his painful and dramatic story has its roots some 7,000 miles away, home to one of the world's deadliest conflicts.
Born and raised in war-torn Congo, Nene, whose mother and siblings were kidnapped in village raids, spent much of his life on the run. The day his world turned upside down mirrors the bloodshed between Hutus and Tutsis in neighboring countries depicted in the film Hotel Rwanda.
Jesus, no.
Oh, it's Simon, Papa.
Don't look.
It started like any other night. But then, gunfire awakened his sleeping family. Raiders were attacking the village. Since the attackers usually targeted the men first, Nene told his wife to take the children and run, while he ran the other direction, hoping to spare their lives.
What we said was, it's only God who can save us now. Let's run.
He returned the following morning to a heartbreaking scene. All the village houses burned to the ground. He was told his wife and kids were dead.
It was at that time that I realized I'll never see them again.
Alone and fearing another attack, Nene decided to flee, praying,
God, if we are Christians, why is this happening? But in my heart, I felt a voice saying, look at the life of Job. So I realized what I was going through was not even difficult.
2 months later, he found safe harbor, traveling nearly 1,000 miles from his home in Congo to Rwanda, then on to Uganda, and finally Kenya. All the while, he relied on his faith in God and the help of strangers. After 3 years in Kenya came good news. He was going to America as a refugee.
I was happy, but I said, God, if my family was alive, I could have gone with them to the United States.
Nene made mid-Missouri his home. The only thing he brought with him was the Bible he escaped with during the raid, and in it, a picture of his wife, Francine. Hoping to put his painful past behind him, Nene poured himself into his work, just as he did farming, teaching, and preaching in Congo. He also pledged never to remarry unless he knew for sure Francine was dead.
I had a feeling that maybe my family could be alive, but when I looked around in the natural, I said no. I am cheating myself. But in my spirit, I felt strengthened.
Nene found work as a custodian, but his true calling is the ministry. He leads African worship services every Sunday here at First Baptist Church in Columbia, where his congregation, co-workers, and friends have become family and a network of support.
Instantly, our hearts were just connected, and he just became my son.
One of his biggest supporters is Charlotte Gaddy. They met when he came to her bank applying for a car loan and bonded over their common faith in Christ. Nene calls her Mama Charlotte and her husband Papa Steve and says he no longer feels like an orphan. A year after coming to America, Nene received an unexpected phone call. His wife and all three children were alive in Kenya. But he'd wait another 4 years, enduring holdups like outbreaks, paperwork, and canceled flights. When they finally got the green light, Mama Charlotte sprang into action, helping with immigration details and finding a place big enough for the family to live. With the help of donors and fellow believers, she organized a citywide effort to furnish the family's new home.
We went from an empty apartment within a week, a completely furnished apartment, from everything from tennis shoes to silverware to, God supplied everything, and everything was color coordinated.
Last summer, after 11 years apart, Nene finally reunited with his family. The couple shared their experience with CBN News.
Once I saw them coming through the doors, it was overwhelming. I cried there at the airport.
They say their story can only be described as a miracle.
Deep in my heart, I knew my husband was dead because we had witnessed so many times the raiders coming in and killing the men in the village or taking them into the bush. And later we would find the bodies of people who have been killed there. Looking back and seeing what happened, the only thing I can say is this is God's doing.
It was like another wedding we have gone through. We have been wedded, my wife and our children.
I asked Francine what she thought when she first saw her husband.
When I last saw him in Congo, he was younger. He has grown older. He has started losing hair on his head.
No, I'm still young.
Nene, when you saw her, did she look the same or even more beautiful?
Beautiful, very beautiful.
Nene and his family have spent the last several months getting to know each other. His kids, whom he last saw as toddlers, are now teens, adjusting to life in America. And he's getting to know an orphan boy his wife found and adopted after the village raid. But it doesn't end there. Nene became an American citizen in February, and in April, he and Francine welcomed their fifth child, a baby boy they named Israel.
This is a baby of joy.
To me, It's like a present I have been given.
Nene admits it's tough supporting the family on his income, not to mention having to repay the U.S. government nearly $8,000 for the family's flight to the U.S. But he says he's grateful and wouldn't change a thing. Meanwhile, his family's still inspiring those in the community and all who hear their story.
This couple represents so much in faithfulness of God and their vows to each other and the holiness of the vows. And they were faithful to the vow to God, and they were faithful to each other. And God used that in a miraculous way.
John Jessup, CBN News, reporting in Columbia, Missouri.
You know, we hear the word miracle so many times, but truly
I tell
a
you.
Miracle story.
And baby number five.
Wow.
God bless them.
God bless the entire
bless them
family.
Gorgeous, great story, John. Stay with us. We're coming right back. Well, finally today, a Knoxville man won the largest lottery jackpot ever awarded in Tennessee history, $250 million.
Well, the twist, though, is he's a member of a religious order and has taken a vow of poverty. Roy Cochran.
It's going to be my job to work very hard to make sure that every single penny of this prize is a blessing to whoever it touches.
Cochran is a member of the Society of Saint John the Evangelist, an Episcopal religious community. Nevertheless, he went and claimed his prize, choosing the lump sum of $115 million. He plans to set aside enough money for retirement, make large gifts to a long list of charities, and start a foundation to support performing arts organizations. Wow.
Okay.
Well, as long as they have the right goal.
You got it.
That's it for CBN News Today.
Make it a marvelous Monday, everybody.